So, now that we've finished the Fossil Fighter streams, it's time we get to the second part of this whole Pokémon clone series. Actually seeing if these games are indeed actually Pokémon clones, and also just providing a general review of the game. Looking at things like mechanics, writing, design details, gameplay loop, and just generally sort of things like that. Alright, the first thing I would like to establish is that... is just why almost every single monster fighting collecting genre, almost every game that fits in that genre, is almost always considered a Pokémon clone. And that's for no other reason than no other game dominates a single genre in the same way Pokémon does. When it comes to movies, games, anything like that, nothing dominates a single genre as overwhelmingly as Pokémon does. But it is not the only series to have done this. I mean, even looking back as... it is just a complete an anomaly within the entertainment world. Digimon is the closest thing to a competitor for Pokémon in a pure perspective. And it doesn't even come close. So the idea of a Pokémon clone is just a bit too harsh of a comment to make on something. Because the idea of monsters battling each other has existed for years, even before it. We'll go into this a bit later, but Godzilla pretty much did almost the exact same thing as what Pokémon does, just about 300 feet taller. Pokémon itself was not the first of its own kind. However, that put it aside, we're going to be looking at this game on its own merits, more importantly. Starting things off, we're going to dig in a bit to the development of the game, the concept which would eventually evolve into Fossil Fighters, as stated by Nintendo's own, and I apologize for the name right here, Hitoshi Yamagami, was proposed by Red Entertainment around 2004. When they first proposed the idea of having a game that just involved dinosaurs. I would like to point out, Fossil Fighters came out in 2008. This game was at the very least in discussions and development for 4 years. That's actually around on par with what Pokémon games are. When it comes to this game, it gets a reputation as a Pokémon clone. While there are indeed some similarities, and I think it is only right to look at these and really give the game a fair chance, elements, typings, attributes, whatever you would call them, a table chart is Pokemon's biggest mechanic. It's debatably the most iconic thing of Pokemon, and it is the most complex system of its kind in any series there is. But does that mean every other series is just copying it? Not really. Again, it's not exactly its own original thing. It's just broken down to a much, much more simple state in many other games and other forms of media. Final Fantasy games have weaknesses to certain magic or materia, and even just anime and manga like Naruto have its own chakra advantage-disadvantage cycle where certain things are good against certain other things. And those aren't even games. Those are just, again, anime and manga. The way Fossil Fighters does it is a lot more in line with these, where it is simplified, it is cyclical, where Pokemon is a gigantic network. Again, Pokemon didn't exactly invent the idea, but it is by far the most complex there is, and it is pretty much what popularized it in the gaming sphere. It was largely one of the first of its kind in gaming. And it's one that, because of how long it has been a dominant force of gaming, again, Pokemon's been out for a quarter of a century. It's been out for 25 years. And it's one of Pokemon's biggest mechanics. It will naturally be linked with that. But it is not the origin of the concept itself. Even the way Fossil Fighters handles its element system is actually quite different to Pokemon. Pokemon can learn moves of several different typings, whereas in Fossil Fighters, you can only use moves of whatever your particular attribute element is. Again, different. Everything from Magic the Gathering to Naruto to Yu-Gi-Oh! And even Bakugan have done very similar, if not the exact same things, of more cyclical things. Second to the typing emphasis is the Pokemon main focus of collecting them all. Bloom's Pokedex, things like that. Yes, to a degree, Fossil Fighters does similar. But it is not as overtly stated as Pokemon has generally made it out to be. And when it comes to Pokemon, it's a lot more you, player, fill this thing up. And just hands you the Pokedex. Again, there is lesser of a focus in terms of just the general development of it, but they still do have a bit of a focus on it. And to a degree, Fossil Fighters does something similar. Pokemon does have an emphasis on collecting all the Pokemon, especially with the way the game, right at the start, outright says, you player, fill up the Pokedex. The way in which Fossil Fighters does it is it dances around this in a dialogue perspective. It's not as overtly done. The collection emphasis of the game is actually more emphasized in a functionality perspective due to the way the game's support system in terms of secondary effects, the support zone buff and debuffs, status effects, the typing system, and just the simple fact of the more you go through the game, the better Vivisaurs get in terms of pure stats, moves, and things they can do. That's where the collection mentality really tends to come in. It's a pure practicality origin rather than stated purpose, I guess, is the way to say it. Yeah, it's incentivized because of functionality and really player convenience more than just the game telling you this is your express purpose in here. Even when the game does have comments relating to collecting everything, it is more of the generic encouragement of NPCs said in a bit more of a tongue-in-cheek way, like, oh yeah, you'll definitely get all of them one day. It's said more tongue-in-cheek and generally in a bit more of a comedic way than deliberately, oh yeah, you should definitely collect every single one of them. And the same way that Pokemon does. Again, this collection aspect is a lot more helpful when you consider post-game. There also is an actual reward for collecting every single 100 standard Vivisaurs in the form of Dunarapin and Dynamation. So, and that with the Shiny Charm didn't come out until, what, 2 years later when Black to White 2 had the Shiny Charm? Even though the game actually handles the legendary Vivisaurs, they are gotten as rewards for defeating endgame super bosses. Which is completely different than to just chuck Pokeballs at legendary Pokemon thing that just Pokemon does. Even when it handles its legendary Vivisaurs, gotten as rewards again for defeating those same endgame super bosses, while saying nothing of the fact that team skills are a thing. Yes, Pokemon does actually have its own spread area of effect moves, and there are the pledge moves, which are sort of a bit of a team thing, as well as your helping hand. Nothing is in the same capacity of you put these two things together, they become a lot stronger, with the exception of like Plusle and Minun with plus and minus. There are very few, if any, things that operate in an even close to similar manner as the team skill effects. Experimenting and figuring out just new compositions through support effects, type coverage, and just the team skills are really what drives that collection incentivization. Again, it is a practicality, functionality perspective rather than simply you're just supposed to collect every single one of them. Now, this section is where the game will actually be a bit diverging from the mechanics that Pokemon has or brings an emphasis to that Fossil Fighters also has similarly but executes in a very different way or for very different reasons, to something that is definitely leaning much more heavily on an aspect of Pokemon particularly, and this is the BB Bandits. Yes, the idea of antagonistic groups looking for a powerful MacGuffin to take over the world is pretty much a standard gaming trope in everything. It's a gaming trope. Even just media in general is the same way. It's the plot of almost every single thing that has ever been made, ever. But the BB Bandits particularly follow the Team Rocket template. Very overtly, they feel as though Team Rocket was just transplanted into Fossil Fighters, given a new costume, and that's all. Bulworth particularly does feel like a carbon copy of Giovanni, getting bested by the player in their own base after outing themselves as the boss of the evil team, holding a position of prominence in public, police chief for Bulworth's case, and the 8th gym leader of Kanto for Giovanni, going to find the strongest monster there is so no one can stand a chance against them when they fly to take over the world, again, Friggy and Mewtwo respectively. Even the trio of BB bandits, Vivian, Snivels, and Rex, are uncannily similar to the Team Rocket trio from the anime, Jesse, James, and Meow. The bossy woman who always acts like she's in charge despite never actually doing anything right. But I will say Vivian does at least seem more competent than Jesse, the guy who's pretty much just comedy relief in the trio, and the village the animal mascot, who's actually the smartest one of the three, and also walks on two legs, and at some point also speaks English directly to the player. Unlike the previous two things where we went over that were very different executions of a similar concept that is very easy to mistake for being a carbon copy to something that is actually only a similarity on the surface level to something that is heavily seemingly based on, it is hard to justify that this was a coincidence or a mistake, as it does seem very deliberate. Is it possible it wasn't intentional? Yes. But taken with this, in addition to all of the other things we have gone over previously, it does really compound the similarities to give that more skewed perspective of looking more like a Pokemon clone rather than anything else. Yes, the Denarians are the main ones behind everything, but that doesn't really come into play in a story focus until significantly through the game. So really adhering to the stock and standard Pokemon style for so long does give that impression of being a copy. This really is only changed when Duna outs herself as an alien, and it really does break its own original story. Until then, while the hinting is actually quite clever and quite well done, it is laid throughout a very solid portion of the game, it is very easy to forget or not pay attention to this and realize what's happening. Again, kids will be kids, and people will be unobservant people. With how intentional it is, and yes, with the plot being really in control from the Dinorians, I can also say that it does feel like it was an intentional fake-out to give the impression of being a Pokemon clone before pulling the rug out from under you. With the big plot twist being like, no, this is not a Pokemon clone, take it seriously. The problem is, again, kids will be kids, reviewers will be reviewers, and people won't really get the point. They will see it as a Pokemon clone and not let its own originally come through because either a clickbait or just they don't have the sense to realize it. Again, one of the big failings is it was very well done, but it fails in this way specifically because it gives off this impression for so long. A lot of it was a bit too subtle. Back to more positive things. Monster fights. We all love them. Yes. Like the first 2 points back to went over, again, Pokemon heavily popularized this as a game idea. But again, the concept of monster battles predates Pokemon by a good, near half century? Again, Godzilla had that down cold in the 50s. Then there's like Alien vs. Predator, even Magic the Gathering, and Marvel itself have actually had significant amounts of media where monster or monster things fight one another. Again, making things fight one another is not exactly a new thing. Let them fight. Again, Pokemon popularized it as a video game format, but it is again far from the only media to execute that concept, let alone that being its main concept. Now let's look into the mechanic of how these battles work. How they are similar and how they are different to Pokemon, and, well, I guess how Pokemon and the Vivisaurs really... We'll be right back. The battle properties of Pokemon are pretty well known. Attack, special attack, defense, special defense, speed, and of course, hit points, HP. Each Pokemon gets a maximum of 4 move slots, varying types, whether offensive category or status, as well as having passive abilities. Evasion is held constant for all Pokemon initially, with accuracy only varying between moves. Unless a stat modifier is applied from some external factor, of course. Health items are also a thing, and every Pokemon is able to take an action per turn. It is required to, in fact, take actions per turn, unless an external factor specifically states it prevents an action from being taken, such as flinches or moves such as Hyper Beam, which have a recharge time. And every move consumes a specific power point resource for that specific move. Muscle Fighters is actually somewhat similar, in that it has attack, defense, evasion, or speed, of course, depending on which game, accuracy, and life points. However, unlike with Pokemon, evasion is not held constant between each Vivisaur, as we have been over with speed and evasion. They are the exact same things, called by two different names, between Fossil Fighters and Fossil Fighters Champions. The accuracy does not vary depending on the move. It depends on the Vivisaur itself. The move or skill being used as well. Accuracy is not, of course, varied depending on move or skills, as they are called here. They depend on the Vivisaur as well, so every single matchup will always have a different accuracy and evasion chance. Hit chance is determined by a Vivisaur's accuracy and the target's evasion or speed, again, depending on which game it's in, they're called the same thing. The accuracy does also factor into the critical hit rate. Passive effects, passive abilities, are present in Fossil Fighters, but not in the everything receives one capacity that Pokemon has. Most Vivisaurs don't even have them, and many of them that actually are existing within the game are drastically different than anything Pokemon has. Auto counter that Spinax has, Delta's FP Plus, and so on, while Lombao or T-Rex just outright have no passive abilities whatsoever. Fossil Fighters also have a second passive effect system in the form of the support effects. While stationed, of course, in the support zone, a Vivisaur will activate its support effects. These are things that they themselves are not capable of taking advantage of. They are stat modifications based on percentages applied to either the allied attack zone, in the case of generally, which are stated on the specific Vivisaur themselves with their specific support effects, such as this Vivisaur will apply support effects to its own AZ, or this Vivisaur will apply support effects to its opponent AZ. Generally, positive effects are given to allies, negative ones are generally given to enemies, but there are negative effects that do apply to allies as well sometimes. Vivisaurs also do not have an individual move resource for their attacks. It is a shared resource pool, Fossil Points, which is shared between all three Vivisaurs, and the use of one move will consume this communal pool of FP. Vivisaurs can also voluntarily not take a move in a turn to build up a higher reserve of FP. So, again, the way in which the battles are conducted are drastically different. Passively speaking, again, Pokemon has nothing like this, with the only possible exceptions of a very, very specific and generally Pokemon-specific condition such as Friend Guard or Sunny Charim Flower Gift, which is itself a very large stretch. This is also say nothing of the range system, which these games do have, where depending on your placement on the field relative to the target, your Vivisaur does have a specific, unless your Vivisaur does have the specific trait of long range, the distance between your attacking position and the opponent's defending position will determine the amount of damage reduced, if at all. The only closest thing that Pokemon has is in triple battles where flying type moves and some exceptions can hit non-adjacent Pokemon in only specifically triple battles, and This is just an even further stretch when you consider that Generation 5 Pokemon was not even out yet, and it wouldn't be for over a year. Again, as we mentioned before, the Vivisaur's communal power pool of fossil points adds a lot more depth to gameplay to stack fossil points up over multiple turns and use it in an all-out blitz, or use it gradually as time goes on with weaker moves. Again, very, very different in terms of how things go, as well as the allied Vivisaurs. When one is KO'd or knocked out, the owner will be granted twice as much FP as their normal gain, unless it is not at the maximum fossil point cap, which there is a maximum cap. When it comes to stat changes, buffs, and debuffs, Fossil Fighters also handles this very, very differently. Buffing moves like Harden or Quicken only increase a Vivisaur's stats by a set value, such as something like 15 points. This is drastically different than the way Pokemon handles stat changes, which is actually percentage-based. As we've actually mentioned already, the support effects are actually percentage-based, so there is a percentage-based modification for stats, but these range across evasion, accuracy, defense, and attack. Whereas those are things that really needed to be specifically modified in the case of certain moves. As we've already mentioned, the debuff effects are very similar to the support buff effects, which trend to a decrease of a set number rather than percentage for things such as Excite or Enrage. Even many of these debuffs that are present are drastically different than Pokemon. The only two that operate in a somewhat similar capacity are Poison and Sleep, which are two status conditions that are actually in most games. Most games have either sleep effect or a poison effect, and even these wear off in one turn for poison, and they say in this game, whereas in Pokemon, again, they are persistent. Again, very different. Even things like Confusion, which are the same name as something in Pokemon, but still perform drastically different in that it is a random action that will be taken, with Enrage and Excite being nothing comparable exists in Pokemon. We've also mentioned, again, the buffing differences. These are permanent in Pokemon, unless, of course, the Pokemon is switched out, whereas in Fossil Fighters, these buffs and debuffs are wearing off after a turn or two, depending on what it is. Again, very, very different execution of two somewhat similar concepts. As well as when it comes to the use of these moves, a move such as End Flame or Quicken can be used by one Vivisaur, but gifted to an ally. You can't just give a Swords Dance to your doubles partner in Pokemon. Again, they behave extremely differently when it comes down to the actual ins and outs of how these battles work. There are some common things, such as hit points and typing advantage, but those are things that almost every game has. A lot of the particulars are drastically different. All in all, outside of the BB Bandits, if you're not just taking a surface level look at this game, there is not much to back up this game being a Pokemon copy. A lot of things function drastically differently, and the similarities there are, but just because there are some similarities, again, outside of the BB Bandits, doesn't mean it is just simply a direct copy. This game does have its own ideas and its own execution. Being called a Pokemon clone, and people calling it a Pokemon clone intentionally, really does take away from the fact that this game is, on its own, quite original, as well as it just devalues the game on its own. Is it perfect? Of course not. It is basically just Jurassic Park as a fighting game. Or really just any kid whenever they played with their own dinosaur figures and just made them fight one another. Again, see that scene from Jurassic Park 3 where the little kid is playing in the sandbox making the herbivores fight one another, where Dr. Alan Grant is lecturing him about that. This is something that just kids do because they're kids. It was natural something like this was going to happen. It isn't the most original masterpiece ever created, but it does have its own ideas and concepts that have been around for a while, and it brings them together in a new way. And really, it doesn't have much that was intrinsically only this because of Pokémon. The game is not a Pokémon clone. If this game was meant to compete with Pokémon, Nintendo would never have made it. With that first portion of the video done, we can move on to the more centric portion that is around this game, the actual review of this game. And starting off, I am going to have to say some unkind things, and that is about the gameplay loop. Yes, there is a lot that does go into the battle with strategy and everything like that, but realistically, outside of the super bosses, and even then, most of them don't really need the most incredible amount of super deep team preparation thinking. In the main story, it is ridiculously easy to overrank with fossil chips and cleaning, so the gameplay ends up going mostly grab fossils, clean them off, repeat. And if things aren't going great for you, just change up your team, sell jewel rocks, buy fossil chips again, repeat, and mash attacks through every single fight with super powerful supporters. Dynamic battling strategy doesn't really come into play unless you can't overrank. And the only time that comes in is when you are fighting level 12 opponents. Remember that even when you fight Ganache as an end boss of the game, it's rank 8. And just in our playthrough that we did, we were able to pretty easily hit rank 10 consistently. You guys even saw that once we got Guan, we abused the heck of that plus 90 attack stat for Spinax. And then just in the case of Earth types, we had Venator just to destroy everything else. We did the same thing against Friggy with the super bosses. It gets repetitive very quickly, and on its own, it is very, very monotonous because the game does not present much of an actual challenge for large parts of the game. With the only true difficulty, I would say, really coming in the form of Dynol, where that's simply because of the higher FP gain than you can match, and the simply busted support effects that Duna and Rapton provide. As well as that he has team skills that he can spam that hit everyone, and has skills that prevent rotation. It's kind of the game deliberately going out of its way to be almost as unfair as you have been to the actual game against you. On a more positive note, this is writing, and this is where the game truly shines. I love it. It is very funny, it is aware of the ridiculousness of its own scenario most of the time. There's a lot of very comedic exchanges. At the same time, it is legitimately very well written as far as the game does go. With the exception of one point, which we'll be getting to later. Despite its absurd concept, they explain almost everything. Everything from the Denarians to even Dr. Diggins' time travel is actually foreshadowed and hinted at very well throughout the game. While yes, at times Rosie is very annoying, she really isn't that bad all things considered. She's certainly better than Sakura. They even do explain why the revival technology exists, despite no one even questioning it throughout the entire game. It's something that you think that they wouldn't need to address, or really even think to address, because it would break really the immersion of the story. But they do, and it really immerses even more. However, all that goes out of the window with one bad part. Ganache. Unlike everything else in the game, it just kind of comes out of nowhere. It is given next to no build-up, and really only exists for two reasons. To give you another big boss to fight at the end, and to make Dynol not look like a complete dick. The reason I say that it is the only bad part when I've given my complaints to the overtly Pokemon-esque story before, with, well, Bulworth and the BB Brigade, is because that whole portion of the story feels almost satirical of the trope. It doesn't take itself seriously if you actually look at it, and it's making fun of that story concept. They even aren't like, yeah, they were able to just pay him off with a crap ton of money and he was willing to do it. It's like, and he just went mad with power. They poke fun at that concept. Unfortunately, we are back to negatives here, and that is visuals. Even for 2008 standards on the DS, these are some pretty poor-looking visuals. Even outside of blowing them up for the series. On the DS and the emulator as well, the screens were actually rather shrunken down. They didn't look that great. The reason I say this is because of Fossil Fighters Champions, which, yes, also doesn't look great on its own, but shrunken down, it looks miles better. And that only came out a year and a half later. Likely, it was in development alongside of the game. I'm really someone who does not care much for graphics. I think that gameplay itself is what matters more, and while I do actually prefer the art style of Generation 5 and Pokemon had to anything we've had since, I will draw the line here because of how exceedingly pixelated everything is when it is meant to be a 3D environment. When a game is meant to be 2D, and it really doesn't shy away from the fact that it is very pixelated, again, going back to Generation 5 of Pokemon, it does have its charm. They are not really shying away from the fact that, yeah, it will look pixely because that's, well, the point. With this game, the animations do look extremely primitive. They could very easily have touched them up a lot more, and the gameplay loop, as small as it is, it really does need something to dazzle us, which these graphics certainly don't. The writing is, of course, very comedic, and the writing on its own kind of can compensate, but the writing is not something people are going to predominantly pay attention to. There are definitely things that do look very good in the game, and there are definitely times where the graphics do look very good, but most of the time, they just don't. Switching from one aesthetic to another, I know this is going to sound a bit odd, but designs. This game just, it goes way over the top with how it designs these things, and it makes everything look pop. They did a lot more than they actually needed to when it came to the visuals of the Vivisaurs themselves. Yes, the visual presentation of the game is not overly great. The creativity and the vibrancy of the Vivisaur designs does sell it very well. It does shine through really the not great visualization of everything because of the pixelization. They went above and beyond what was actually needed to really make these things. Honestly, I could sit here and for the next half an hour list off a few of them. The deliberate blandness of Megalo, the sail of Spino looking like a sun and its body looking like mummy bandages, Krona being covered in Roman numerals, which is amazing because it's called the Time Lizard, Kronosaurus. The creativity and the care they went through to design everything shows through the less than stellar graphics, and it's amazing. It shows that this really wasn't just some Pokemon knockoff. They put a legitimate amount of time and consideration into what everything is going to look like to make them emblematic of where they are from or something that relates to their history. I know we've already gone over all the mechanics and really all there is with that. It's complex, it's neat, it's very rocket science-y, it opens up a lot of things you can do when you really understand it fully. It's fantastic. The problem is, you don't really need it to play. But the thing is, that in my opinion just makes it even better. You shouldn't need to use these super rocket science-y mechanics to win. They should be encouraged and able to be used, but not forced to use them. It's optional, and it can really make things fun when you understand them. It is just a shame that the other half of the gameplay loop, the cleaning and recovery, is as repetitive as it is, and it's also the main focus. The battling is a bit more secondary to the fossil collection. With the main story out of the way, we can at least look at postgame now, and there really isn't much to speak of. There's the Time Machine side quest, the Coalfoot Glacier snowberries and monster, which we didn't really go over, the Oasis spots in the Parchment Desert, the rematch of the Rosie and Holt, the BB Trio, Sarhad and Dynol. When you beat the game, you are given access to the last 20 standard Vivisaurs you need to get Duna, Rapton, and Dynamation. There are the battles with Dynol himself and the three brands of Ganache that you can, of course, refight again. You can collect Igno and Friggy by, of course, battling Sarhad again and the BB Trio. But that's really all there is. It doesn't really take overly long until you get done with the grind. Leveling yourself up to rank 12 to fight all of them is a bit of a grind, and even then, not overly long, and fighting them is not exactly difficult. Except within the case of Dynol, who is pretty much coming as close to cheating as possible without actually overtly cheating. It is a very neat thing, and again, I do like the whole time traveling to fight the final boss of the game, but it is only there to level grind, which is the problem. So you level grind in post-game to get one thing. For getting every 100 standard Vivisaur to level 12, you will be given access to the 5 chickens. That's all you get. The only point of leveling up every single thing is to get even more things to level up and just do nothing with. Kinda useless. Outside of Dynol, there really is nothing that is a challenge, and again, I do like the idea that at the end of the game, it actually shows that he acknowledges you as the hero, but really, outside of mentioning it in the newspaper and really Dynol mentioning it once, there really isn't all that much to do. Now with everything wrapped in, my final thoughts. I think it's a decent game. It entertains me quite well, I enjoy playing it, and there's a very good amount of high point, and there are high points, there are low points. But at the end of all this, it is a very much a once-in-a-while game. It's short, and it's simple. It's a nice roll down memory lane, and while it's not as good as I remember it being, it's far from as bad as I was expecting it to be on revisiting. It's far from bad as I was expecting it to actually have been when revisiting it. I was really expecting it to play like a, well, more standard Pokemon clone game. I was expecting it to play like a standard Pokemon clone game. But it doesn't, because it's not a Pokemon clone. It's very much its own beast. I wouldn't go so far as to say it's an absolutely stellar game, as in one of the best there is, but I can in good conscience say I recommend it. That's all I have for now, and I do hope you enjoyed this. If you want more, you can watch my replay through the series that we did, and you can watch my replay through unfold on the streams. Of course, we have that marked. It'll be likely in the description below. And this was scripted out well in advance of the difficulty analysis series for Pokemon, so we've got more videos like this in the works, which is funny because it's actually the last one of them that I am recording, even though it was the first one that I scripted. But we've had more videos like this of this nature as a discussion series that we've had. If you like these, please go check those out. It will mean the world to me. Thank you very much here. And I gotta recharge. See you guys.